Welcome. It's a great pleasure to welcome Fabrizio Barozzi this evening to talk about the work of his practice, which he shares with his partner, Alberto Veiga. One of the first striking characteristics of the practice is that while it was founded in 2004, barely 13 years ago, it has already produced an impressive body of work, from cultural and institutional to exhibitions and installations and to urban plans. And while one can simply assume it is the result of practicing in Europe and operating through public competitions, an assumption many of the envious practices on the other side of the Atlantic probably quickly make, clearly there is something that is more specifically the result of design and intent rather than the happy coincidence of being in a certain context at a certain time. One way to trace this willful design intent, whether the practice or the work itself, is to take a trip through Barozzi Veiga's website. It seems a little easy to rely on a firm's website to think through its practice, but as the academic year comes to a close and the subject of representation and of representing one's work is feverishly spreading across students at this critical juncture, I thought it might be an interesting exercise. This is particularly tempting since architects' websites are often notoriously bad, and theirs is unique and especially uniquely striking. First, there's the even black and white photography, which renders the certain monumentality of the work clearly present. The play with scale, the strong and simple figures, the importance of apertures in the solid masses, the striated materiality, whether vertical or horizontal strata or grid-like fields, the light and its revealing of texture, all work to produce the effect of buildings that are designed for a kind of silent yet very powerful aura. Then there are the drawings, simple and also evenly black and white, that render plans and sections a renewed kind of diagram, at times singularly isolated and at others embedded within the city, often represented as figure ground with an emphasis on its morphology, again emphasizing the apertures and voids within the urban fabric itself. Throughout the work, the city is in fact omnipresent as inseparable from the architecture which it is in dialogue with. This investment in representation is not accidental, of course, and is a privileged window through which to understand the work that it generates as well as it captures, the strength and clarity of its position, the intent of its effects, and the beauty of the built artifacts that result, at once simple and powerful, bare yet textured, shaping the present while also irrevocably building a new continuity with the past. This holding together of seeming opposites transpires through Barozzi Veiga's practice, as they have said about their beautiful installation, A Sentimental Monumentality, at the last Venice Architecture Biennale. I quote, "It is the opposition between monument and sentiment that our work and the meaning of the installation lie. In the pursuit of an architecture that is specific and autonomous, intimate and monumental, which aspires to belong to a place and at the same time belongs to all places." Building on this tension between the specificity of place and the autonomy of form, the practice has grown a body of work that is at once always deeply embedded within its context, but also undeniably continuous and consistent. This growing body of work has been met with equal growing interest and awards. In 2015, they were awarded the European Union Prize for Contemporary Architecture, the Mies van der Rohe Award, which recognized in particular their Philharmonic building in Poland. In 2014, the studio was selected as one of the Design Vanguard 10 Firms of the Year, Architectural Records Special Award for Emerging Practices. And in 2013, they received the Young Talent of Italian Architecture Award granted by the National Council of Architects, Planners, and Landscape Architects of Italy. Fabrizio graduated from the Istituto Universitario di Architettura di Venezia in 2003 and completed his academic studies at the Escuela Tecnica Superior de Architectura de Sevilla. He has been an associate professor of architectural design at the Universitario de Girona since 2009 and is currently enjoying MIT for the semester. I have to tempt you to come to Colombia in the future, I hope. But in the meantime, please join me in welcoming Fabrizio Barozzi.
Okay. Hi everyone, and thank you to the dean for the introduction. And it's really a pleasure to be here to present our work. It's one, I think, the most important lecture that I have done here in US. So it's really an honor have the opportunity to talk about our work here. But before for the lecture, for today lecture, I've prepared. I will present you five projects and one installation. Probably they are the most representative project we have done during these 12 years that since we started. But before starting the presentation, I would like to say you just a few words about our office or about our way of work. No? So we start in 2004 in Barcelona, and the studio is composed by me and Alberto. I'm Italian, Alberto is Spanish. And since the beginning, we started to work with competition, but also working abroad in Europe. You know? So this maybe ideal condition that link an architect with a local territory, you know, with a city or a region or a context in a way, in our case, it didn't exist. No. So since the beginning, we started working in abroad and in different contexts, in different reality, with different cultural background. And in a way, this biography data has shaped our way of work. No? Since the beginning, we started thinking about the notion of specificity. No? We started thinking about what is specific, no? How to face different contexts that you don't know, no? And I think that this biography, in a way, has transformed or modeling our way of work, and since now, this idea to be specific, in a way, it's very, very important for us. Or if trying to explain better, I think that our work resides in a paradox, in a way. No? We try to find in all the project we prepare, we present, we try to find the balance between the specificity of the place and the autonomy of the form. No? And this is basically a paradox, a dichotomy. It is impossible to solve that. It doesn't make sense. No? But in a way, I can assure you that exactly there, in this space in between, no? In between from something specific and something autonomous, reside our work. No? And before the lecture, I had a small interview with Aisha, a colleague of us, no? And she asked me which are our obsession now. No? And I think that this dichotomy that for us has been very, very important, now it starts to create sort of language in a way. So I say to her that during these 10 years we were not interested in creating a language, a personal language. So we were interested about how to solve very specific problem or condition. No? But now I think that we are trying to define maybe it's a personal language, but starting from the specificity of the place. No? I don't know if you can understand me, but it's exactly an opposite starting point from other architects in a way, no? How to how you can find some key element able to create a language, but starting from the diversity and the uniqueness of different places, no? And maybe now we are exactly in this moment in our practice. Recently, at the Biennale, we had the opportunity to reflect again about our work. No? The curator asked us about what is our everyday battle. No? So we tried to take advantage about this opportunity and reflect through an installation about our work. So we decided to do not exactly an installation, but a project. No? And we did a very simple column, in a way, that in a way is at the same time something very specific for this place, no? But at the same time it's something autonomous. No? We decided to work at the Corteria, and in a way the project rise from the site. It's a site-specific project in a way, but at the same time we did a column that is an archetype, no? Something that has its own rules, yeah, in a way. And we talk a lot about the title of this installation, and at the end we decided to call it a sentimental monumentality, because in a way what we tried to do in this project was to highlight in a way or monumentalize what is specific in a way, no? So start it from what you found in a place, you try to highlight it, make it more evident, and transform it something in something more universal, no? Starting from a very specific condition. So what we try to do is discover this sentimental link or emotional link with a context, no? But at the same time discover what is monumental, so in a way independent and autonomous, no? Able to transcend the specific condition of one place. And this idea were also very important at the beginning of our career. One of the first project we did represent this way of working quite clear, I think. This project is a small office building, basically, for a regulatory council that control the quality of a wine in Spain. The project is placed in a small village in North Madrid, in the Castilian Meseta, this very flat, horizontal, archaic, and old territory. And in a way, this geographical condition, no, this boundary condition, has marked the project since the beginning. No? The project is set on the limit between the city and the landscape, and this double condition, this duality, reinforce also or create the project. From one side, the project just complete the urban context, just try to be sensible and define and complete this element. But from the other side, another archetypal element try to establish a relationship with the horizon, no? With the geography. So if we see the building from distance, the building is just the end of an urban condition, no? And mark the, you know, the end of the city in front of the landscape. And it is appear like a very simple element, precise, archetypical in a way, that try to have in mind this landscape that surround the building, this old landscape, this whole territory that conform this region of the Spain. No? But if we start to see the building more close, we discover that this autonomous and independent building start from a pre-existing building that we restore and transform. And if we turn a little bit around the building, we start to discover this dichotomy that I try to present you at the beginning. The building is something very specific. It's tried to establish a continuity with the pre-existing building, with the landscape in a way, but at the same time, the tower become something more independent, more autonomous. No? And this image, I think, it try to present visually what I try to explain you at the beginning. This stay in between, no? From a specific condition and autonomous condition. And the tower, in the tower there are places, the main representative spaces of the building. But what is important is the project, is that in the central part of the site, it doesn't exist really a building, but what appears here, it's a public space. For us, all of our projects are created starting from the our reflection about the public space. For we intend many times the architecture just a frame of the urban. And here, in the middle of the site, we decide inside of a private building, we define this small plaza surrounded from buildings. And this image that represents this plaza, it's like a manifesto. No? What is important here is not the architecture, but is the void here in the middle, no? That the architecture conform. Many of our projects are cultural or public building, and in a way it is important that this building try to give something in return to the city. And also a private building could conform a public space in its heart. In this space we try to work with this different condition. From one side this space is quite intimate, that facing the landscape in front there. But we are interested in discover unexpected scenario, discover how an historical element could be transformed and present a new condition in a way. We are interested in create such of a microcosm in a way, no? We are interested in create this hybrid condition, no? Where the contemporary element discover a continuity with the pre-existing element and create an unexpected scenario for a context in a way. And this small element that complete the fragment of the city are basically some big skylight that take light into the building. And in order to achieve this clear and precise relationship with the city, the program is controlled very precise in a way. Here, for example, the great part of the program, it's underground in order to to make free this space and create here the public space. And here is the auditorium with the light coming from the skylight. In all our building, we try to find the precise materiality able to establish this intimate connection, no, with the context, with the pre-existing building. And for example, here in this project, the entire building is covered by stone, but it's not a ventilated facade, but it's really stone. And in order to give to the projects some gravity, some density in a way, in order, and this permit also to control the time of the building, how it will be transformed during the year. More recent, we finalized also another project, a philharmony in Poland, in the north of Poland, in a small city very close to Berlin. And this image that you see here is taken from our office there. No? The image is not so good, but in a way it represents how is the city. Szczecin is a patchwork of different conditions. No? There are some socialist housing blocks from 70s and 16. There are some part of the medieval part of the city. There are some Gothic monuments in a way. So for this project, we have the idea that the project have to confront with this condition, with this uncertain condition. So, and here you can see the original drawing of our closest neighborhood. It's the building on the side of the Philharmony. And when I speak about specificity, it means also try to learn from what exists. We start all the project with what we found in a place. And here we found this building. This building that speaks about verticality, speaks about mass, speaks about repetition. And this specific condition has been transformed by obsession, by our personal interpretation, and the result is this small model that represents this autonomous element, but that rises from a contextual condition. The Philharmony is sitting here, and it is the first step of a more general reorganization of this quartier, that now it's quite depressed in a way. And from an urban point of view, the building just fix a corner here and try to clarify a condition that was not so clear. Also because, you know, this city has been was completely destroyed during the Second World War. So the result is this building. In a way, I can say that all the elements that appears in the project, you can find it also in this small building there. No? The building speaks about the identitary condition that conform the character of this city. So what we try to find in our work, it's the right tone, the right tonality. Discover this point in where it's possible that the building establish an emotional, a sentimental continuity with a landscape, but at the same time try to make a new step, no, in a way. And I think that this building is speak about that. The only expressive element is the roof, no, this stupid roof, no, that permit that the building establish a continuity with the skyline of the city. So in a way, we try to make a building that is a part, a new part of the city. For sure, when you try to think in a project, there are other ideas that floating in the mind. Here, maybe there are something expressionist in this building. And without any nostalgia, we modify the material. We don't use a traditional material in order to highlight the independency of this building from the context. But so the only expressive element of the building is the roof here, because we try to be synthetic. We try to solve and create a figure just with a few elements, and here we use this the roof. But also because when you arrive to the city, you discover the building, no, surrounded by this tree. So the only visible element is the roof, no, and here is from the park that is behind of the building. So, as I said, the starting point of all our project is the reflection about the public space. Here, for example, in the ground floor, the half of the ground floor is occupied by a big foyer that basically it's a public space inside of the building. So it's a covered plaza, in a way, a space for the city where the citizen can use it and can stay there. And this space is characterized by the stairs that permit the connection with the exhibition area here, and characterized from the hall in this part and the light coming through the skylight. In a way, what is important that the architect is just a background sometimes. It's a background where the things happen in a way. And we try every time to solve a very complex problem, like in this case, for example, it's a big symphonic hall here, another chamber hall here, with simplicity. All this complex program in sketching is solved by three elements in a way. There is one crown here that contain all the technical element, vertical element, installation, and so on. And in the middle of this crown are places the two big hall, and the interstitial space is basically the public space inside of the building. And the building is easily understandable. There is a loop, no, that start from the foyer, go up there, cross the entire building, arrive in the upper floor, and return from these stairs. So there is an internal loop that the visitor can move freely through the building. It is important that the building are understandable from the people, no? And this is the upper level, no, where the path from here and the path from here joined here in the exhibition area. So this floor is suspended over above the foyer here, and there are a visual connection between all the levels of the building. But the heart of the project, the Philharmony, is the symphonic hall. How to conform a contemporary symphonic hall? In a way, what we have done here is basically try to reinterpret a tradition, in a way. And we start thinking about section, light, and ornament. The section, as you see here, it's basically a reinterpretation of a classical typology, no? And we also start thinking that also the decoration or the ornament could be a link with an history. So we started thinking about a detail, a triangular surface, no? that conform an ornament, and then the repetition and the transformation, the variation of this element could conform the entire whole. So our goal in this space was to work in continuity with a history, but try to give a new step of a tradition. And this idea of ornament, that I think that is still important in a way, in order to thinking about contemporary architecture. And an ornament is not an ornament if it is able to solve a technical issue. In this case, all these surfaces basically are conform like this in order to create the best acoustic. No? So in a way, the goal was to link a decoration and technique in this case. And the light is another element able to establish a continuity with an history. The light permit to transform the materiality of the whole. The entire whole, it's work of craftsmanship. It's an artisanal work. It's made in wood, but covered with golden, synthetic golden leaf. And speaking about specificity means also discover how you can work in a particular place. And there in Poland was possible to conform this type of work, because there are still an artisanal tradition that permit to create this type of space. So everything, it's appear natural and simple, but starting from here, we are able to conform an entire wall. And the facade is also a sort of ornamentation in a way. The facade is composed by a different aluminum profile, and behind there is a white glass. And this permits that the building is very sensible to light and transform its materiality during the day. And when the night approaches, the building starts to change in its materiality. We can feel that an activity it is inside of the building. And so the building that at the beginning was solid and monolith, it became more lighted. It starts to discover that something happened inside. And it changed dramatically its presence in the city. And at the night, only the light conformed the shape of the building. And in the morning, the building became another thing. And I think that here in this building, the most important thing has been that the citizen and the city understood the building, start to use it, and now it's really a cultural and social center for the city. At the end, our work as architect is exactly there, in a way. Try to give, to return to the city something, you know. And here also in this image, you can start to understand how the building, you know, give continuity to this landscape, you know, this urban landscape. More recent, this summer, we have finished another fine art museum in Switzerland. And this museum is placed here. It is an extension of an historical museum, no? Just in the limit of the historical center. And this image show the villa that actually hosts the museum. It's a beautiful building, quite bizarre in a way. It's a neo-Palladian building, but where there is a Orientalist decoration in this part. It's because it was the house of a man that became rich, giving things from Egypt. And this, maybe this Oriental condition has been interpreted also by Peter Zumthor, that in 1982 he had this winter garden here and there, no, with this very beautiful wood element in this part. So here, for example, at the beginning there is some Sphinx, no, and so around the building there is a romantic garden. No? This was the original condition, no, with the Zumthor element, a connection here, and a building that has been demolished in order to conform the new extension. So the project was very, very complex because we need to organize in this very small size a big program. And here also you can see this scheme of the original villa that is based on the La Rotonda by Palladio, no, in a way. So this, how to say, this absolute condition, no, of this reference that has marked the original building, in a way has also an impact through our building. So what we have done is exactly this, try to extract the axis and the geometry, the Cartesian geometry, from the original building and conform the new project, the new addition, in continuity with this building. No? But what is important to notice is that here also the conformation, the organization of the garden here, this public space, has been crucial in order to make this duality became coherent. So like in a diptych, what we have done is try to preserve the independence and autonomy of each building, but at the same time try to conform both building with the same element, with the same identitary element. So, and the result is this, in a way. There are two buildings. Every building has its own history, in a way, at its own figure, but there are the same elements that conform in different ways to these two buildings. So, in a way, this project is still something specific for this place. I can see that the project, it's a neo-Palladian building because it's conformed by a double symmetry, and the exhibition area are conformed by a sequence of room, in a way, like the Villa Planta, no, the original building. And also there is this idea of decoration and ornamentation that it's present in the original building, that here has been transformed, it create something new. No? So in a way, this building, like the other two, speaks conceptually again the same thing, no, but in a very different, with a very different language. And maybe you can start now to understand what I said at the beginning, that our effort now is try to create a language starting from the context. No? And here there are other different view of this of the project. And here it's not possible to understand clearly, maybe through the image, but this small space that surround the building here, it's absolutely crucial in order to conform a coherent urban unit. No? The two buildings are an unitary urban element into the city. No? But in order to conform this public space here, this small public space, we basically organize quite radical the program. The exhibition area are placed here underground, and we let outside only the public space, the public area, the foyer, the pedagogical space, and other space for atelier and in this part. No? Again, like in Rohe, it's a program, it has been solved very, very clearly, very precise. No? It's and what we have done is just try to conform the building in its in about what is essential in a way. No? So the foyer here show this relationship with the historical building. The historical building conform basically the facade of the new foyer. No? It's maybe long to explain, but here this area is the foyer, but at the same time it is the delivery area because a truck can enter here and the elevator is there. So we try to compact the building at its maximum in order to maximize the public space around the building. And this drawing that you saw here, it's one the drawing that I'm more interested about our production in a way. It's the building is basically conform with two core here and no more than this. So the structure, the construction, the program, it's organized with two very simple elements that conform a public space here in the middle. And the same, the law that is marked here, it's transformed in the other part and transformed in something different there. So there is a big stairs that go down through in the exhibition area. No? This is the level minus one where is placed the permanent exhibition. And as I say before, the exhibition area are just a sequence of well-proportioned room here in a Palladian way, in a way. Now, and here there is the connection with the exhibition area that has been transformed by Peter Zumthor. The interior are very simple, clear. Here there is the connection with the Villa Planta, with the original building. And the level minus one, there are just the two core, and it is conformed by one big room that permits the maximum flexibility in order to present the temporary exhibition as there. The materiality is still absolutely crucial in order to create this link with the pre-existing building, with the context. Here, for example, we in Switzerland, we have the possibility to conform an extraordinary concrete bas relief that conform the entire facade. So the entire facade is composed starting from a detail. This it's a module by in concrete that is 15 or 50 centimeters that conform the entire facade. So when I speak about specificity and I say it is important to take advantage from the opportunity that you have to work in different places. And there in Switzerland, we have the opportunity to conform a very sophisticated facade no, that conform the entire building. No? It is the opposite, in a way, from the Philharmonie in Stettin. But here, this element is the door from the delivery, and it is a disconnection no? Into the building. The building is conformed by a double symmetry, in a way, but this element that is very significant, that it is the reason why we are able to conform this ground floor here, it represents a disconnection here, no, and it marks also the starting point of the building. And so at the end, what we have done in this project more or less is the same of what we have found the first day that we visited the site and the atelier. We discovered these two very beautiful sculptures by Giacometti, one on the side of the other, everyone with its face, with its identity, but everyone that speak has its own character. No? Now we are working in Lausanne for another fine art museum that now it is on site. The site of this project is very big. It's all this building close to the rail station. And this site is full of different industrial building that you, for the maintenance of the train. And there is this building, it's a hall by, it's 1911. There is a big arch here, no? So, and the program for this project was to reorganize in these sites the three main museums of the city, the museum, the Fine Art Museum, the Museum of Photography, mm-hmm. and the Design Museum. Here is a picture from the interior of this historical hall. So, this is the site, the actual condition, and we have to place it there, the three museums. So we work a lot in order to discover how to transform this historical hall. But in one moment of the process, we discovered that was more important in this case, find a urban strategy in order to place it there, the museum, then reorganize an historical element. So we start thinking that the architecture and the urban could be combined in a way, no? And again, the architecture could became just the frame of the urban. So our scheme is that one. What we decide to do is put in the heart of the site a new big public plaza here that is connect with the plaza of the rail station, and this element it's able to link the new building here with the city. This scheme represents the second phase of the building where the two museums are combined in one element. And this image shows our proposal for the competition. And what is important here is not the architecture in itself, but it is this public space, no, here that we can discover, that we can give to the city. And again, the project is something specific for there. The museum is just a container, an industrial building, like the historical building that there are. There is something very abstract in a way, very rigorous. No? The entire building here is made in brick. So in a way, in a different scale from the project for the Ribera del Duero, the architecture is still modeling from the public space that in this case conform this plaza. And the building, it's very simple. It's basic and inhabited wall that divide the new public space here from the railway in this part. And what was important is that, okay, we decided to demolish a part of the historical building in order to give a new public space to the city, but we also discovered that it was possible to preserve a memory of a place starting from a constellation of different fragments. And one of the fragments this element that was the most beautiful and maybe the most interesting element of the historical hall become here the figure, the principal figure of the new composition. The museum is just a background, no? Where a neutral background where it plays this figure there that became the main compositive element. And from the other side, the museum is very permeable, very open in order to give life to this space. So again, the project is very pragmatic. The ground floor is conformed by all the public area, the foyer, the cafe, the auditorium, etc. And this small element from the pre-existing, it became the new foyer of the building. So the historical art, it's the element, the key element of the new foyer, of the new composition. These are the stairs. There are two stairs that go up to the different floors. And these represent the second floor of the building. Again, a very complex building is solved with simplicity. There are just a few core that organize in a very pragmatic way the program. Temporary exhibition, permanent exhibition. Again, the structure, figure, and composition are organized in one, just in one coherent element. And this is a representation of the second floor where there are the light coming from the ceiling. And the last project that I show you, it's an experiment for us. We start, after 10 years, we start to have the possibility to return to design a house. And this is, we made this house last year. It's an house for a weekend. It's a weekend house. And this is the landscape in a picture taken from the side. It's a natural site. There are no pre-existing element. There are nothing, just the landscape. And so when you have to design a house, you have to discover which are your main and more deeper intention in a way. So we decide where to place the house, on the top of a hill, no? And there we just place some small pavilions. So in this case, we are not interested to conform an object, but what is more important was to conform such a domestic microcosm. No? We are interested to conform this interstitial space, no? In between these different pavilions. So the plan of the house is very, very simple. There are four pavilions, one entry pavilion, the house, an exterior space here, and the swimming pool in that part. So again, we try to reduce the project to its to the fundament in a way. And the house is conform a platform here, where there are places, just some shelter in a way. This shelter contains the main house, just with the kitchen and the living room, and there are two stairs that go down in the another level, more intimate, more protect, where there are the room. So the client asked that to create not an house for living all the day, but just to enjoy and stay there for a few days, for a weekend, no, and start, and where you can establish a particular relationship with the landscape. So when you arrive to the house, when you let the car abroad, you discover a path, and you enter here to this pavilion, this small pavilion, you discover a different temperature there. This place, the house, it's a place in the south of Barcelona in a very warm climate. So you cross this small entry pavilion and you enter in this small, I don't know how to say, these small villages made composed by just four pavilion. And here again, what is important for us, it's the relationship that you can establish with the nature around here through the building. This important space is the space in between of these different shelter. This view, it's the opposite view with the living area here, the entry and the exterior area in that part. So again, we try to conform the house just with one element, this element here that is not a column, but is not also a window. It is something in between. This space represents the living room, no? And here there are the other pavilions. This is the exterior area, no? Covered area, and the swimming pool in that part. So, I hope that with this project you have a more general idea about of our work. And at the end, I think that what for us is important is to discover the diversity and the uniqueness of the different context. And starting from there, discover how to interpret these different conditions and create at the same time something that is able to create a personal language, start from this diversity. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I've been a big fan for a while, and I've been really enjoying your monograph. And for those who don't know it, it's 20 projects, 20 words. Mm-hmm. And what really struck me about that is that it really emphasized what you've been talking about for the last hour, that those 20 projects actually are not labeled by their project names. Mm-hmm. It's the city in which mm-hmm. the projects are located so, mm-hmm. in. So 20 projects, I think 6 or 8 of them were in Spain. Mm-hmm. So the first thing that I was struck by was that you don't have what is typical in terms of how we define the context of our practice, that there are the national projects versus the international projects. That ratio alone and the fact that you represent, you know, you identify it by city, not by country or any other means, in that you're just looking at the specific context every time, and that is much more important. So I wanted to start with that word, context, and to ask you to elaborate a little bit more on the context of your practice, just to kind of pull back a little bit. You started in 2004. Mm-hmm. Let's say that was the height of the Spanish architectural scene. Mm-hmm. You grew up in the post-Franco era, started at the height of that, survived the recession. Mm-hmm. It's okay. But there's also, and so I'm curious about the kind of what you started to say that, you know, from the very beginning, you were in a sense a borderless practice, that you are You're Italian, your partner is Spanish, you started automatically with projects abroad and have been working in various cities. So I'm curious about the context of that practice and how has that changed at all? Do you imagine that it might change in the current political context that we are in, where we seem to be locking down our borders.
Yeah, I have to say that we are really an atypical office in a way, because our career has been quite different from the career of all of our colleagues there in Barcelona, for example. And as I say at the beginning, this international condition that we had since the beginning, not because we're looking for that, but just because we start to work with competition in Europe, has marked in a very important way our way of work, you know, in a way. So we start to make project with a size quite big. Mm-hmm. Now we are returning to the house after 10 years. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have work when the in 2004-05 that was the top of the moment. Mm-hmm. But then we survived the crisis working abroad, for example. So it's true that our trajectory, our career has been very, very difficult from the other part. And also this is for this biography, for these histories that we focus our attention in this idea this notion of context, no? Because our personal history, but also because, for example, I studied in Venice, and there there were an important study tradition about this notion. So I think that part of this, my background, it is has marked my career and my way of work. So for me, this notion of context, I think that that has been very put away during the last, I don't know, decades or something, was not so important. I think that is still important in order to for my work to discover an architectural thinking. Mm-hmm. And basically, it's for us, it's a way to try to reject what is generic in a way. Mm-hmm. No? So working with this idea of context, of what is specific, and try to define every time a very precise project, permit to move away from a generical condition that I think that's been critical and in architecture during maybe the last 15 years or something, no? But when I speak about context is not only a physical thing, but it's a cultural thing, it's a social thing, it's an economical thing. So all these different points, we try to understand and interpret all these different contexts or reality that exist in a place, and start the project basically from there.
Right. I think that's an interesting point, and I was wondering about other contexts, or call them narratives. What really comes across in your work and how you draw your work, how you represent the work, is the how you deal with the historical context, whether that is by looking at the typology, the building typology, the courtyard typology, or whatever mm-hmm. the kind of the urban mm-hmm. fabric is, the materiality of your projects. It tends to be what you tend to draw and represent is the physical context that you're working in. And so I was wondering about the other contexts that are there, but you don't necessarily draw them. That is the social, perhaps the political. And I'm also thinking about the context of North America, where often these contexts are much more front and center, particularly the ones that have to do with the social, the political, the economic, the energy, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So can you elaborate on how those other contexts are folded in and the decision to, in terms of what you represent?
Yeah, but for sure, we draw and we represent and we think in the physical context in a way as prioritary in a way, you know, to develop the project. But it's true that behind this drawing that establish a relationship with the physical context, there are all these other contexts that you explain. A context means discover how to work in a place, which are the possibility of this place in order to elaborate an architecture, how to build the building in a way, or which are the advantage that you have in a place and not in the other place. But this is another important thing that every time in our mind. No? For example, it's not evident, it is there. And for sure, for example, this idea to maybe you can identify our project in a very simple and bold figure in a way, but sometime what is behind this figure, this image, it's even more important than the building. For example, the idea to conform the public space that is crucial in order to establish also a social condition for a project, if it's possible to say that, no? Sometimes is the key, as it is the starting point of our project. Maybe it's not easy to perceive it in the project, but I can assure that this is the most crucial element. No? It's another type of of context. And also, for example, we really try to condense the building in the main element. For example, also to control, the economical condition of the building. I didn't have time to speak more about sketching, for example, but this building has been built with a very, very, very low budget. No?
Philharmonic Hall.
The Philharmonic Hall, exactly. So we were able to build it also because after many years we was able to reduce also the economical cost of the building because the political and economical condition asked us to make that. So these are the other contexts that mark the project in a way. All the decision about materiality or the space has been keeping in mind these constraints, for example. So it is another contest that has marked the project. But so there are a constellation of different constraints and contexts, but it's true that for us it is important to to create architecture in a way. Architecture has a physical condition, no? So there are different concepts that conform it, but at the end what you can do as architect is conform an object that maybe, if you are lucky, it's able to establish this intimate link with the context, no? Through the physicality of the building.
I think I just want to make maybe one or two small comments before opening it up to questions from the students. This is probably an oversimplification of your work, but you spoke about this idea of creating either through void or through exterior void or through interior void, the idea of the social. And I found it really interesting that in your plans, there's far more consistency in how you make spaces in plan, where you're always kind of compacting and solidifying the necessity of program, the cores, etc. And then in between, whether it's inside that lobby of the Philharmonic Hall or in between the building footprints mm-hmm. of Roa, there's the public or the social or the flexible space. There's a very clear kind of hierarchy in plan. But what is always surprising is the section. And so, again, it's probably a complete oversimplification, but I was thinking about, you know, what you presented as the dichotomy, that you're trying to create specificity and diversity in each project, but underlying that is this kind of consistent approach, consistent architectural language, especially now 10 years mm-hmm. plus looking back, trying to find that consistency. Mm-hmm. And for me, oversimplification, more consistency in the plan than in the section. There is always a very idiosyncratic, mm-hmm. actually, relationship mm-hmm. between plan and section.
Yeah, maybe. It depends in some... I think it's difficult to we don't think about a project starting from the plan or, right. or section, or we start to think more globally, no? But it's true that through the plans you can sometimes feel how the building fit in a urban environment, mm-hmm. no? So, and all our plans try to be very, very precise in this sense. And also, there are super simple sometimes, but if you are able to achieve this very basic and essential and simple and dense plan at the same time, that suddenly discover an unexpected relationship with the environment, it's important. It's what we try to find. So maybe in the plan, it's they discover what we try to do from a urban point of view. Mm-hmm. But then, for example, the section, sometimes they discover how the program is organized in order to achieve this possibility, in a way. And sometimes the section are quite, from my point of view, even more simple, but the same radical in a mm-hmm. way, no? Because, for example, in Rohe, we decide to work with the slope, for example, mm-hmm. in order to achieve mm-hmm. the space. In Kur, for example, mm-hmm. Has been the same. Or, for example, in Stettin, where this element permit also to organize technical elements, structure, and so on. So,
but it's also in the section and in the elevation profile where you are in dialogue in very local ways with the diversity of each local context. And it's very clear, you know, the long bar building of Lausanne, of course, is very different site response to that of Chichen. Mm-hmm. How do you pronounce that?
Stettin. Stettin. Yeah, it's I don't know exactly how to explain, but the in a way the section is very, I don't know, all the buildings are very pragmatic in a mm. way. We try to find this point where, I don't know, you can solve everything with just a few elements, no? And maybe in Lausanne, for example, this big element, it's more than architect, it's an urban strategy in a way, no? Mm-hmm. And the elevation declare this strategy in a way, right. no? Also the duality from one side and the other side. So I don't know exactly, but all our thinking it's around to find the best way in order to fit a building into the space, and as I said at the beginning, find the right tone. No? Mm-hmm. For me, it's very important. Mm-hmm. This more than language. It's speaking about tonality, speaking about tone. It's very important. No? For example, the museum in Lausanne. It's very direct. Very. Mm-hmm. Strong also. It's a huge building. It's 150 meter long, just a container in a way, no? So it's quite impositive there, no? But because the site condition asked us maybe to conform that. But for example, today I didn't show another project that we have in Italy for a conservatory, for a music school there, where basically the building is just, from the outside, is basically just a wall that complete an existing context. And it's almost, the project, it is almost anonymous, no? So it doesn't appear there. So it's, the Lausanne and this other project represent how for us is important to find the right tonality, mm. No? Mm. The right strongness of, right, of the right. building, mm? More than other things.
So I'm going to stop projecting my own desires onto your work and let the audience do that. Do we have any questions? Someone in the back center.
Before I come here, thanks. It's interesting, before I come here, I usually go on the website and see what the work is. And when I looked at your work the first time, I felt it was very tense, you know? I felt really tense. And so coming here, I was looking at your work and experiencing it. And just picking up on what you guys have been talking about, I feel there's a lot of tension in the buildings itself. Like. So sometimes, on the last building, for instance, there was a staircase that was just brick, and I don't know if it's related.
In which building? In the last
Lausanne,
one?
Lausanne.
Yeah. Yeah, Lausanne.
Lausanne, mm-hmm. Yeah. So, so I just wanted to maybe get if certain things are, I guess they are intentional, but what your thoughts are on that, because when I see the buildings, it's in certain space in the building, I feel it's really tense, but then in other space, it's like, wow. I just feel a lot of that in your work, which, you know, for me, it's great because it brings emotion. So I just wanted you to expand on that because, you know, if I was trying to build something that's just like a staircase, for instance, just brick, the way I saw it right there, I don't know if people would say, what is this? it's almost like you push the tolerance for something at certain space in the building, and then at the other space, it's like, it's very, I totally see what you're getting at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but.
Maybe the question is about a contrast between
compression
versus
tension between, you know, like the staircase. Is it something that's you're doing with conscience? Is it related to the context again? Like, are those bricks from the original site and you decided to use them in a particular way because you wanted to conduct something, or am I reading too much into this? But that's just the visceral. Yeah. Sort of thing.
But what I can say is that, as I said, it's many of these project has been with different material, no?
Yes.
So also the material condition of a building for us is absolutely important and crucial in order to establish a link, a connection, or a relationship with the context. No, for example, in Lausanne we use brick, and in Coeur it's in concrete, and Lausanne it's aluminium, no, for example. So it's another way to to trying to finding this tone, no, that I speak in, no.
Yes.
And then in the interior space, it depends. I don't know exactly, but we try to push the project at its limits,
yeah.
In
okay.
a way,
that's,
no? And
yeah.
and
yeah.
That sometimes happens. Sometimes it's not enough. So we have still to learn a lot.
But I'm impressed but with what you. Yeah.
Sometimes the we don't think in terms of how is these stairs or how is this skylight or how it is other element. But we try to find a global coherency inside of the building. And for example, in Lausanne, I can assure you that the building is 12,000 square meters, so it's quite huge. Mm-hmm. But at the end, it's conformed by four cores in a way, no? And solve this building in this way, it's not at all simple. It's a pure simple, but it's the result of a process of reduce the building to mm-hmm. its minimum term, no? And then the other element, the stairs or openings, so it's appear where it makes sense in this general coherence, no? In a way.
Well, thank you. I really
thank
feel
you.
Like you've pushed the limit, like, and I've never seen it so drastic in a space, and it's sort of like it's amazing that I find that you got it built, it's got to get accepted. Most people, yeah, some things, I don't know what the most drastic thing you tried to pass through that didn't get accepted, but I think you're really pushing the limit, so thank you.
But you know, it's what we try to do, not to, but I think every time we try to make a better project than the previous one, no? So I know what is, it doesn't work in the first project and what mm-hmm. work better in the second one, and we try every time to make the project more essential in a way.
That's mm-hmm. definitely coming across. Another question? Two, one in the corner, one in the front.
I'm interested to hear you talk about your design development relationship with your partner and how you make each other stronger in the design process.
It's
or weaker.
The question is about how we work not together. Yeah. I see. Yeah. So we don't have a different role in the office. So basically the project the process of project it's based on dialogue, discussing a lot and follow, I don't know. Every one of us is make critics to the other ideas in a way. So, and we try at the end to find something, the most strongest idea that we have, no? And sometimes, this was at the beginning. Now it's true that we start to have quite a lot of work. It's true that, for example, I follow a little bit more the conceptual part of the building, the starting point of the building, and Alberto is all sometimes more focused in the construction part of the building. So it's a very generical division, no? It's like this. I don't know, we start working in this way maybe 2 years or 3 years ago because of the general organization. But what is more important is that we still understand the design process as a dialogue between us, no? If you propose an idea that the other is able to, or you are able to, you can defend an idea that is just an impulse, so it doesn't work, and maybe your partner can tell you honestly that, you know, this doesn't work.
I think we have two questions, right? You're next, and maybe the last, or there's another one, but go ahead.
Sensibility that can be compared to some projects maybe of Giancarlo De Carlo, like the Magistero in Urbino. So I want to understand what is the weight of the role of references in your project and how they affect your production.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, I use these references just to try explain some idea in a way, no? These images that I show, so recently we have done a book where we present our work. So one idea was try to, describe every project with a word or with a general concept that for us is important. So in order to explain this concept, we use also some different references, no? So these references for us, for me, are important in order to try to transmit an idea. But for example, we for some references that I show, we didn't use this reference as a starting point from the project, not at all. But in Cour, it's true that I show this image basically because the original building is a neo-Palladian building. It's declared that it's coming from this this building. And for me, it was important in this case to show these references because this idea of absolute that you can feel in this project by Palladio, in a way, has been an important thing also for thinking our project in a way, no? This idea of double symmetry, simplicity, and combination of rooms, for example, no? So I chose this reference because basically it's explain how is the original building, no? So basically are a way to transmit idea, but is not at all a starting point. And about Rohe, for example, I think that this building, maybe it's the most the most contextual one, and that I present today. In our beginning, this project, another project, maybe we were more interesting in complete something, but was not so clear how the building, where was this idea of autonomy that maybe is more present in the new or more recent project than the first one. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Can you answer one last question?
So my last question has to do with the start.
Can you make that microphone work or speak up?
Hi. Thank you very much for the presentation. Just related to the first way you started the lecture, and what seemed like you were trying to do was outline somewhat of a, not a manifesto, but a design idea or design theory, an approach that you want to go through. And whenever I think about these, I always think about composition and your awareness to context, and it's sort of, it's in follows fighting the autonomy of the building. And I wanted to ask where the opportunities or the outlets for your personal desires or
your the opportunity of
for your the outlets for you to express your desires in terms of composition. Where do you find the gaps for you within that awareness of the context to express what you want or how you see the building should work? Because especially in the European context, it is very strong, it is very present. And so I'm kind of interested in how you navigate that to express what you want or to envision the building in the way you want.
Yeah. No, it's and these are very interesting questions, no, in a way. I don't know. During this year, we have done this this project. Basically, it's true that we worked in a very consolidated context, no, in a way. So we have different possibility in order to establish relationship with different pre-existing or something. So we have some material, no, in order to create a project. But so when, for example, the for us now is important also to discover in a way which is our language in a way. When we start to find or work in a not consolidated context, for example, the house that I show here, it's for us, it's a, it is an important build, an important project in a way, for two reasons. First, because of the typology of the project, it's a project, it's a domestic project. It's not exactly an house, but it's similar to an house, in a weekend house. So it's a different size from the other side. And also because this type of natural, in we didn't work before in this type of natural and not constructor or the urban environment. So you have to find there your own voice in a way, no? So we try to solve this problem, no? Try to be even more basic and even more simple and even more. I use during the interview a word that I like so much, even more archaic in a way, and no, or primal, no. So basically, the house is composed by different shelter, and that is just a structure, no. So probably our intention is going in this direction. Try to be every time, I don't know, yeah, maybe primitive in some time, maybe.
I think on that note of returning to the beginning of the lecture and also returning to the beginnings of the search in your practice is a perfect place to end. So I thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation.